Amen. Let somebody shout it loud, hallelujah. Several months ago, we began to look at a topic which we never finished. I intend to run it up today. I also intend that we go into an area that will require strong prayers to bring us breakthroughs. I know that if you are here this morning, you did not come by chance. Because if God wanted to organize you to be somewhere else, He would do it so easily. The power that has brought you here, the power that establishes the heavens and the earth, shall arise and fight for you. Amen. Let your amen roar like thunder. Amen. You see, our major problem sometimes is that most of us were born out of position. When you want to start your journey in the east and you were born in the west, you need to move back to where you're supposed to be. You were supposed to be in the east, you were born in the west. So you have to move back. That movement sometimes is not easy. In fact, that movement is what some people call the battle of my life. Moving from where you have been dispositioned to where your correct position will be. I'm praying for somebody here. If the enemy has relocated you to a useless place, the power of God will relocate you in the name of Jesus. We started off, I think it was last year, on 40 marriages that must not hold. And we covered 20. So let's see what we can do today and quickly rush it up so that we can go to other things next time. The last time that we were here, we shared from Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. It is still extremely relevant to what we're going to discuss here this morning. Genesis 2, 18 says this. Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. And the Lord said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an helpmeet for him." That day we defined marriage. What is marriage? That's where we started off. And I told you the reason we are teaching these things now at this level, that if you understand it at this level and you position yourself properly, you will not get into the trouble that many people in adult church have gotten into and they are now trying to get out. They say prevention is better than a cure, because the cure may not be effective, or there may even be no cure. There may be no cure. So we define what is marriage that day. And I gave you some hard facts about marriage that day when I came here. And then we went into looking at the Proverbs 18:22, which we are coming back to zero in. "That he that findeth a wife, findeth a good thing, he obtaineth favor from the Lord." Then we now began to look at the various marriages that must not hold. Fast food marriage. That's the one. I'm just rehearsing what you've done before. Where I recapitulate and to summarize, for the sake of those of you who are not here, then let me just quickly summarize what you've done before now. Fast food love. The fast food marriage. The one based on wild lust. Foolish love. Two. Serpent in the pocket. Marriage based on marrying the enemy of God. Three, Red Cross Society. Marriage based on accidental pregnancy and abortions. Four, Thus saith the devil. Marriage based on demonic consultations. Five, witchcraft marriage. Marriage without divine approval. Six, syringe marriage. Marriage based on blood covenant. 7. Maximum prison marriage. 8. Half-bred marriage. That is based on the principle of it is better than nothing. Let me just marry him like that. Since I'm getting late, let me just marry anybody and anything like that. I will manage him. Now, laboratory marriage, trial and error. Sample this girl, this one is not good enough. Sample this one is not working straight. Sample that one, I don't like the smile. Sample that one, I laboratory marriage. 10. Diabetes marriage. Sugar. Just looking for sugar. Looking for sugar. So how much is your salary? 60,000 a month. I don't like you. Then say another one. How much is your salary? So I've just been raised to ₦500,000 per month. Hey, God fed. 11. Angelina to Devulina. Marriage based on satanic prophecy. 12. Nursery school marriage or kindergarten marriage. They donated the girl at a young age. Donated the girl at a young age. Or your dead father left a young wife for you to marry when you grew up. It happens. 13. The dark marriage established by occultic means. Then, number 14, the stranger. You marry a person you really do not know. It's when you got in, you started, is this the man that I married? Is this the woman? 15 is a wiper of tears. Marriage based on sympathy and not love. I just sympathize. You just sympathize with the person. The person was crying, you were crying, and the crying carried you away to marriage. 16. As a bewitched marriage. 17. Baby marriage. Marriage without maturity. 18 is emergency marriage. No preparation. Everything is quick. Sorry. Sudden. 19 is distant marriage, which also covers internet marriage, Twitter and Facebook marriage. And 20, show glass, like bones and puff marriage. Just look at it, just display it to the whole world to see. And that's where we stopped the last time. I want to continue from number 21 now to 40. Then we now zero in on what we need to do so that the key thing we need so that we don't make the wrong choice. 21. The 21st marriage that must not hold is the kidnapper's marriage. What did I say? Kidnapper. That is, you just move in into a man's house, or you move in a woman into your house, no dowry, no pastor, no engagement, no traditional ceremony, no law, no church. You just move in. If you move in like that, you become a stolen wife, and the man has stolen. The man has stolen a wife, and you have stolen a husband. That's kidnapping marriage. You were kidnapped. 22. Armed robbery marriage. This, you are forced to marry a person you don't like. They bent your arm and bent your neck and beat you up, call a family meeting, harass you into going there. It's armed robbery. 23. Is the NFA marriage. No future ambition. Your father was a bricklayer. Your mother was selling paraga at the bus stop. And now you want to marry. You are married somebody who they gave a book to read. And the book says, once upon a time. And the person said, Onise Yukon Atime. Yes. Means you have no ambition. You want to go from poverty to poverty. No vision, no goal, NFA. NFA, no vision, no goal. You've married a woman, and the only asset that the woman has is a large breast. That's the only asset. You want to marry a man, and the only asset really is just a slim figure and possibly some fake English that he speaks. Tweeting BBC English, but empty head. Latest perfumes, but empty head. I want you to understand this very well. And that's, you should understand this very, very well. I'm sure there are plenty of people here who are from the University of Lagos. I'm from Unilag. Can you wave at me? You attend the University of Lagos. Oh, good. Shout hallelujah. You go. All those women who are professors in your university, let's say we gather them here. See the way they will dress. Some of them you think they are market women. But when you see somebody who they will say, what is 2 times 2 plus 3? And they say it's 0. When she dresses, I'll be serious problem. In the olden days, when they used to do Miss Africa, Miss this, Miss that, Miss that, they didn't used to bother about their education before they make them Miss this, Miss that. But when they were getting embarrassed, when they would be talking rubbish, then they began to add academics to that you must be educated, at least be able to answer a simple, simple question. Not that you go and represent your country and they put tea for you to drink and they give you sandwich to eat. Everybody is taking their sandwich with one, two fingers joined together. You are grabbing your own. And squeezing into the mouth. Everybody is sipping their tea, small, small. You just carry the whole thing. Wow. I said, next. Gold digger. You are marrying somebody based on comfort and money. You are marrying the person because he is heavily loaded with money. No amount of money can buy love and happiness. Money can buy you shoes, but it cannot buy you legs. Money can buy you spectacles, it cannot buy you eyes. Money can buy you bed, comfortable bed, but it cannot buy you sleep. Money can buy you a Bible, but it cannot buy you salvation. So there are plenty of things that money cannot buy. Money can buy you a house, but it cannot buy you a home. Gold diggers. And gold digging women, eventually they sorrow at last. 25. That is the walking stick marriage. What did I say? Walking stick marriage. I have no father. I have no mother. You know, you are the only friend that I have. So you are my father. You are my brother. You are my uncle. You are my cousin. You are my niece. You are everything. You are married to a person. You want the person to fulfill all these roles that I've mentioned. That is, you want to use the person as a walking stick. Marrying because you want someone to take good care of you, like a baby, walking stick, so that you avoid personal growth. You just hand over your life to somebody. It's a walking stick marriage. 26. Baby factory marriage. What did I say? Many of our mommies are baby factory marriage. That is, marriage mainly for the sake of having children. And all the love the man has, or the woman has, is diverted to the children, not themselves, just baby factory. And once the baby is not coming on time, that'll be a problem. Because the basis of the marriage is to have babies. 27. Escape route marriage. Escape route. That is marriage that is based on you escaping from all the trouble in your family. All the very, very harsh parents. You just want something to get you away from the house where your father is a very harsh sergeant major. You just want to get out of the place. Get out. You don't want to stay there again. They woke up at 5 a.m. They say begin to sweep. You finish sweeping. They woke up again. They say go and cook. You cook. After cooking, they say go and fetch water. You fetch water. I'm tired of this kind of life. At 20, what? No, I must go. And anybody that comes, say please just marry me out of here quick. I don't want to stay. So it's an escape route marriage. 28. Plaster marriage. The plaster you use to treat wound. This is marriage for visa. Marriage for citizenship. Marriage for visa. Marriage for citizenship. You know, it's something that is very interesting that happens at the prayer city. You know, a lot of people come from all over the world to prayer city for deliverance. Those foreign ladies who come, immediately some brothers notice that somebody is carrying about a British passport at prayer city. She has American passport at prayer city. Or it's European passport at prayer city. They become interested. Say, hello. You change your tonation from the Ekiti English to around. Hello, how are you? How are you? God bless you. You want to marry because she has a passport, because you know if she's a citizen, you become a citizen. It's a plaster marriage. You may be surprised. And when you get there, they will deal with you terribly. I've seen it happen. Somebody from Mountain of Fire got a lady from that here, followed the lady. And when he got there, the lady said, well, I brought you here not to work. I brought you here not to do anything. The reason I brought you here is to serve me. So you must serve. Wake up in the morning, wash clothes, do this, do that, sleep with me, finish. I won't work, so you can't work. May you not do plaster marriage. And if you're already a plaster marriage, may the Lord deliver you. Then 29, that is dog marriage. D-O-G, dog marriage. Dog marriage is marriage is based on sexual hunger. You marry just for sex, just for sexual attraction. Touch. One-way traffic marriage. He or she loves you, but the reverse is not the case. You don't like the person, but the person likes you. One-way traffic. It never works out. 31 is panic marriage. Am I too fast for you? Panic marriage. What is a panic marriage? All your friends or sisters or brothers are married. You are afraid that no one else wants to marry you, so you are in a hurry. You're in a hurry. You want to marry on time. Say, my sister will marry next week. My junior sister already married. Am I going to remain like this? I must marry. So anybody, you are panicking. And so you run to a man. Say, look. Sleep with me very well so I get pregnant. So that I can marry. Panic marriage. It never works out. 32 is medicinal marriage. That is, you are using marriage as a medication. Just to cure loneliness. If you want to use marriage as a medication, just to cure loneliness. Unfortunately, you went and married a loner. You want to cure loneliness, then you married a loner, a man who does not talk to anybody. He just faces his computer or television and is not talking to anybody. So, darling, how are you? Fine. When do you want to eat? Later. What food? Anyone? Did you like the one I cooked yesterday?
Yes.
When are you going to bed? Now. All your questions are answered in monosyllables. Yes, no, yes, no, yes, no. So you have married a loner. Does not talk. And you don't want to be lonely. That's why you married. Right, because a lot of people are married but still single. Because the man does not talk to them. So a couple came to see me from America. They started fighting from America. They fought when they got to the airport in Nigeria. They fought at the front of my counseling room. And I said, why you fighting all the way? You came here for deliverance. You are still fighting. He said, Joe, the only time this man is ever nice to me is when he's sleeping with me. Any other time he's very nasty. Married a loner. 33. That is a fine face marriage. Fine face marriage. That is, you marry because of beauty and handsomeness. Unfortunately, there is such a high disparity on the look on your face and what is in your heart. Yes. The look on your face and what is in your heart. A high disparity. Such a large disparity that you wonder sometimes, how can a handsome man like this behave like this? How can a beautiful girl like this have such a violent temper? So like I told you before, marrying because of handsomeness and beauty is like buying a house because of the paint. And when the paint begins to wear off, trouble will start. 34. Prescription marriage. Prescription marriage. That is, they were recommended to you by other people, but not approved by God. Come and say, the way I'm looking at you, you will fit this brother. Or you will fit my son. I like your manners. I have a son in South Africa that I want you to marry. Will you want to consider my son? Show me the picture. So the shape, he said, well, it's not too bad. So it was prescribed to you by fellow human beings. 35 is the cinema marriage. Cinema marriage is marriage in order to, you marry because you want to be seen with influential people. You want to be seen with influential people. You don't want to be seen with the low. You want to marry high and mighty. So when they say, what is your father's name? And the mission is, they say, high chief. That's right, commander in the army. That's right. You just want the top name. It doesn't last. 36. Marriage between Mrs. Husband and Mr. Wife. Mrs. Husband and what? Mr. Wife. This, the woman is in charge. The man cannot talk. 37. There is a caterpillar marriage. What did I say? Caterpillar marriage. You are getting into a relationship and everything around you dies. Work sacked, money stolen, house burnt, father died, mommy died. Caterpillar. The tragedy will not stop after that marriage. So you must not go into it. 38, there is a fixed marriage. Fixed. Say, our family must marry so family. You cannot marry outside that family. You have to marry the person from our town, from our clan, from our street. No other one. It's fixed. If you don't do it, we issue a curse on you. There used to be a lady in Mountain of Fire that came from a fixed family like this. Everything fixed. The person she's to marry is fixed. The house she married is fixed. The village is fixed. Everywhere is fixed. And she went and married one pastor in Mountain of Fire. If you see the curses the father sent to her, I was afraid. I myself as a minister, when I see the curses, the man started his letter by saying, I am a knight of so church. Because you have disobeyed me, may your womb become rotten. May your this and that and that and that and that and that. May your husband, whatever, become like a pillow. May your... Touch that. Second-hand marriage. Somebody is already married. He didn't tell you that he was married. And you got into it for you to know that he's already married. And you say, well, I'm already inside. Let me stay. No. Those are marriages that should never hold. 40 is the CIA or KGB marriage. What does that mean? CIA, KGB marriage. It means marriage that you say, okay, go and know my parents. Say, no. I don't want to go. Let's go to the pastor. Pastor, no. Okay, at least know my mother. No, don't let tell your mommy. Okay, let me know your parents. No. If we go to them, there will be trouble. Let me know your father. My father is terrible. Okay, take me to your family house. We don't have none. It's sunk in the village. So what do we do? I say, let's do it secretly. Let's do secret wedding. Let nobody know. So you quietly, without the knowledge of your parents, without the knowledge of your pastor, without the knowledge of anybody, you went to court and secretly got married to somebody. And then it backfires. These are the 40 marriages that must not hold. In Proverbs 18:22 that we read before, let's read it again. Whoso findeth a wife findeth a good thing, and does what? Obtaineth favor of the Lord. Listen very carefully. There is a powerful product from heaven which will bring you sweatless victory. There is a powerful program from heaven which can admit you into instant success. There is a program from heaven which can make the difference between a mediocre and a high flyer. There is something in heaven that can convert a slave into a prime minister. There is something in heaven that can make you to get sweatless results. There is something in the camp of heaven that can move you to the top, even amongst your enemies that do not want to see you at all. There is something in heaven that is called a divine release, and it will make your way to prosper. There is something in heaven which serves as a ladder to the top. There is something in heaven which can come upon your life, and wherever you go, doors will just open of their own accord. Doors will just open like that, of their own accord. There is something in heaven which is supervised by the Almighty Himself, and it can transport somebody from the prison of poverty to the palace within 24 hours. There is something in heaven which beautifies people's destiny. Unfortunately, the position of Scripture is still very straightforward. Whosoever asks, receives. If you knock, the door shall be open. If you seek, you can find. There is something in heaven that has the capacity to double your financial worth. Whatever you are worth financially, it can double it, it can triple it. There is something in heaven that eliminates you struggling and struggling and struggling to move forward. There's something in heaven that will make people who don't know you to be sweating for you and be fighting for you behind your back. There's something in heaven that can shorten the distance between your dream and your realization. There is something in heaven which is a very powerful weapon to move your life forward. That thing is what we call favor. Whosoever findeth a wife, findeth a good thing, and obtaineth what? Favor of the Lord. Therefore, anyone who wants to find a good husband or a good wife, one prayer that must be really major in your prayer is prayer for favor. Prayer that the oil of favor will drop on your head. And once that oil of favor drops on your head, you become an extraordinary person. The word favor is very, very powerful. Favor is grace in expression. Manifestation of the power of God to help you without applying any arm of flesh. That's what they call favor. When that favor is upon you, everything will be working for you. Everything will work for you. Even the evil will be working out for your good. When favor is upon you, those who are betraying you, their betrayer will become your betterment. When favor is working for you, it is favor that can make them sell a man for 30 coins of silver. And the man they sold for 30 coins of silver, that became a prime minister. That is not that explanation. It's favor. Favor will make you receive what you never asked for, while you will not miss what you ask for. That's favor. I'm praying for somebody here. The favor that will transport your life to the highest level will envelop you in this meeting in the name of Jesus. That amen is not loud enough. Let the amen roar like thunder. As I was coming here, and I saw that brother again. Let me share his testimony. He was a foreman in a company. He was a foreman. He had a supervisor. He had a general manager. He had an MD, managing director. Managing director does not live in Nigeria. Managing director is a white man from France. It was a chemical company. They do something chemical. It has to do with chemical productions. This, our brother, was the lowest among the headship. He was a foreman. Anytime he wanted to come to Wednesday service, the MD, the GM, who is a Nigerian, said no. Who is a Nigerian? He said, no, you can't go anywhere. He said, let me go for service. He said, no. So he could only make Sunday service. And they would just detain him there, not that he had anything doing. Then a day came when I asked people to pray about favor. People prayed that day. And if you pray like that here today, you'll be amazed at what will happen to you. Ordinary, simple prayer, I claim divine favor, can open doors for you anywhere. Claim divine favor, can open doors for you anywhere. Anyway, the general manager was visiting Nigeria. And when he came, the foreman, who is our brother, the supervisor, and the general manager, they were conducting the white man around the factory. They now got to a place in the factory. There was a problem of corrosion or something was wrong with one pipe that was breaking one chemical somewhere. And the white man turned to the general manager. Say, look at that pipe. Look at what's happening there. Say, in chemistry, what name do we call that? The general manager said, I don't know. He turned to the supervisor. Say, yeah, and you? Say, I don't know. Then he turned to the brother, our brother. Our brother said, as the finger of that white man was coming towards him, said something like cold water poured on his head. And as the cold water poured on his head, so he just found his mouth open and he was talking. Absolute rubbish. He didn't know what he was talking. But as he was talking his rubbish, the man said, that's correct. That's correct. That's nice. That's correct. Okay. They went on again. They got another place in the park. There was a problem again. And the white man came to the GM. Said, look at that one too. What's the meaning of that? What how do you describe that in chemistry? GM said, I don't know. They're not chemistry, all these people. Said, I don't know. Turn to the supervisor. Said, no idea, sir. As he was going to point out about the same feeling he had in that first place. Said, that cold thing just poured again. He found that his mouth just opened. And he started talking. And the man said, that's correct. That's correct. Three places in the factory, the same thing happened. So when they now finished the factory run and they went back to the office, the white man said, who is the general manager? I said, see you. So, who is the supervisor? I said, you. Are you, what are you? I said, 4 months. Okay. So it will appear as if the two of you don't know what is going on here. So, foreman, take over as GM. And I said, please, release the company car to him right now. That was how a brother who went to work in Okada came back to Wednesday service in a chauffeur driven car. That can only be what? Favor. Favor. No other thing. Favor. And some of you must have heard me sharing the story of Funke. Funke was a medical doctor. She read medicine in UCH, Ibadan here. University College of Hospital Ibadan. She got to this overseas country, no job. She tried to look for job, no job. Then she now got a job in a very high class hospital where they treat cancer patients. Very high class place, very expensive place. She got a job as a clerk. Doctor, employed as what? Clerk. So sometimes when we see people, I'm going abroad. I say, hey. You are better off where you are. Go. And then problem starts. Anyway, she got the job as clerk. So all she does is to carry file and follow the professors when they are looking at patients from bed to bed. Carry file. Those professors knew that she was a medical doctor, but she's been employed as a clerk. So they go around the patients and talk to them, prescribe drugs, look at them. Those that are terminal cases, they look at them, see what they should do. Funke will be following them on the bed, ward round. One day, we had a crusade. And one topic that was treated during that crusade was the power of divine favor. Funke was at the service. She prayed the way she has never prayed before. When she got to work next day, as they were doing ward round, the professor wanted to mock Funke. As they were doing ward round, they got to the front of a patient and they said, this patient cannot last for the next 1 week. She must die. So they had to just mock Funke. Say, Funke, and what do you think? What do you think we can do to this patient? Funke said, her mouth just opened. And she said, no. These drugs you have been giving her, withdraw it. Give her this one. Give her this one. And she'll be okay. She's already almost going to die anyway. So no problem. We'll use the drug that Funke suggested. Do you know? They used the drug for that patient. And it was as if the whole of the body of that patient, somebody cleared the cancer away. When they came later, said, what's happened there? The patient had, when Funke was saying what she was saying, that patient now became well. The cancer cleared away. The other patients had her too, when the thing happened. And this patient did not stop to talk. Said the black lady, the young black lady said they should do this. The young black lady. So from that day, anytime they got to the ward and they got to the patient and the doctors are talking, the patient will say, let the young black lady talk. Not knowing that she's just a clerk. Those are the professors. So the professor said, okay, talk. Afonka will say, let's do this, let's do that. Everything Funke said they should do, they were doing, and the patients were getting well. That can only be what? Favor. Then one day, Funke went to the head of the hospital and said, "Sir, I want to resign." The man said, "Why? Why do you want to resign?" I said, "Because I'm a clerk here. I need to go and improve myself." "Is that the reason you want to resign? Okay. Will you like to work here? Because if you go, all these patients will almost kill us here." No, he said, "That's not it." He said, "The salary is too small." "Salary is small? Okay. How much do you want?" Just as a joke, she mentioned 5 times the salary of an average doctor. And I said, "Is that all you want? You got it." That can only be what?
Favor.
So favor is divine approval. Favor is divine accommodation. God accommodates you. Favor is divine admiration. God admires you. Favor is divine assistance. God is assisting you. Favor is divine backing. God backing you up. Favor is divine bias. That is, God is biased towards you. God is showing partiality to you. When it comes to your own case, God is very partial. Favor is divine cooperation. Favor is divine kindness. Favor is divine grace. Favor is divine regard. Divine respect. Favor is for the Almighty to make you an exception. Favor is for God to change the rule because of you. They have been employing people on one rule. When it gets to your turn, God said, "No, this is my son. You can't do it like this." And the rule changes. Favor is supernatural assistance for you to become what heaven wants you to become. Favor is for heaven to single you out for honor. Favor is for God to set you. Favor is for the Almighty to give you concession. You're having concession. Favor is for the power of God to stand you out without being crushed. Favor is people showing interest in you without you lobbying for it or begging for it. Favor will announce you wherever you are as a celebrity. Favor is that which should cause men to locate you and deliver your rights into your hands. Favor is what will make men to remember you. Favor is when your helpers, they lose sleep until they come to your aid. Your helpers will be uncomfortable until they come to your aid. It won't be like that brother who went for an interview. The deputy general manager was his father's closest friend. And they were already expecting him at the interview. Are you following what I'm saying? And they went for this interview. The interview was taking place on floor 10 in a building. The brother entered the lift from the ground floor. At the 7th floor, the lift stopped. NEPA took away light. And the lift stopped. Whenever brought back light, the fuse burned. And the lift did not go. The lift stayed in the 7th floor. And everybody was stopped there pressing the alarm bell. Pandemonium. Whereas the interview was going up upstairs. And they were calling his name. He was not there. He was in the building, but he was not there. He was stuck in the middle. The anti-favor spirit had captured him in the place. By the time they will pull up the lift and they will get to the interview spot, the man who was there to gun for him, the man who was already waiting for him, his father's friend, who was supposed to make his life easier, had gone to the toilet to ease himself. And the enemy, the anti-favor enemy, made sure that the man had piling. So that the man did not finish on the toilet. The man was busy groaning and screaming on the toilet. The thing did not come out. It was inside the toilet there. And that was where the enemy kept him until after the interview. And they failed him. The person who was supposed to support him was not there. Anti-favor spirit had removed his supporter. Immediately they finished the interview with him, was there the man could poo-poo again. Then came out. And he had left. That's anti-favor. Favor is what makes somebody out of nobody. You know, you are not qualified for it, you are not entitled to it, but heaven just decided to make you a godly delight. Favor is generous treatment from God. Generous treatment. Favor is divine preference. God prefers you. Irrespective of better qualities of others, God prefers you. Irrespective of the better qualification of the others, God prefers you. Irrespective of the class of degree that you hold, God prefers you. That's favor. Favor is the presence of God upon a man. And it moves you forward when you are stagnant. Favor makes you laugh while others are crying. Favor announces your celebration while others are disgraced. Favor makes you to be a divine wonder, a mysterious wonder, and it gives you advantages over the others. Therefore, beloved, you want a good wife, you want a good husband, you don't want to settle for less of heaven for your life, you need, first of all, to break the yoke of anti-favor spirit. You need to deal with those powers that dry the oil of favor from people's head. 3, you need to pray favor magnetizing prayers. So that once that favor is upon you, I tell you something, you will not make a mistake. But when there is no favor, or you are battered by anti-favor spirit, and there is a problem indeed. Divine favor is what every human being needs to make progress. There is no terrible situation that divine favor cannot turn around for good. With divine favor, there is no limit to where God can take you. If you read your Bible well, by divine favor, people have won battles. Slaves have become kings. All kinds of things have happened to people. Without that divine favor, there is plenty of tragedy. The question is this: how do I acquire this favor? Point number one, you must surrender your life to the Lord. Point number two, you must welcome uncompromising holiness. Holiness unto the Lord. What did I say? Uncompromising holiness. If you are attending this youth church and you are still sleeping around, you are a disgrace to the youth church. You are part of those reducing the anointing of this place. If you are part of these people coming to the church, you are still going about all over the place and doing what you should not do, it is grace. You are a brother sleeping with plenty of people around. It is grace. A sister agreed for them to sleep with you. It is grace to the youth church. And you are killing the anointing that God has put here. And it's a terrible thing to be an anointing reducer in the house of God. I'm aware that there's so many talents here. I'm aware that there's so many prophets and prophetesses here. I'm aware that there are so many people that God has brought here because He wants to move you to the highest level. I'm aware that in this place where we are now, there are people who will be so rich that the whole world will wonder what has happened. But at the same time, the enemy too is planning a strategy so that such people don't get in contact with what God wants to do in their lives. And once you begin to disgrace the Almighty, his own view is very simple. He said, move nearer to me, and I will move nearer to you. So, but if you move away from me, I will move farther away. I know God's leg is very long. So since he has a long leg, if he moves back, he has moved miles and miles and miles and miles and miles away. There is no room for all these strange excuses some people will begin to give these days for doing all kinds of things that the Almighty does not want them to do. You say, with all the messages you are hearing and what God is doing in your life, are you not happy that God is doing this? I'm happy. Then why are you annoying God? Familiar spirit you don't have. Witchcraft spirit, you're not a witch. But then the God that you depend on, you are offending him. How will he help you in the day of trouble? This is a very, very strange situation which a lot of us bring ourselves into, and then we don't know how to get out. Say, why are you living in fornication? A lot of young people, they come, I want to see you, I want to see you. By the time they come, they don't know they're going to see a prophet. Say, you are here. Say, yesterday, 2 days ago, you did this, you did that. Say, yes, I'm sorry. But why? Sometimes they will say, Western, everybody is doing it. It's a general problem. Because it's a general problem, does not mean you should go and do it. Some will fall into fornication. You say, why did you fall into it? Says, because we're getting married very soon. Until marriage, you are still single. So I will say, well, I could not control myself. Then you don't get yourself to a situation where you cannot control yourself. There is never an emergency sex. Sex is never an emergency. Never at all. I know some people, immediately their penis gets excited, their brain will go on holiday. It is after that penis has rested, and their brain now wakes up. The brain now wakes up and I say, hey, supposing this one gets pregnant, now what's going to happen here? The brain did not wake up that time when the penis was excited. It's now it's waking up. It's because my partner is putting pressure on me. Whatever partner is putting pressure on you to sleep with you is not born again, whether it's a pastor or not. Sir, it's not that bad though. I'm not a bad person. It's just once. Some more foolish one say, well, sir, I'm just trying to check out whether it's important or not. I'm checking out my fertility to see whether I can conceive. Some other more outstandingly foolish. Say, sir, I pity him. I pity him. Whenever he is pressed, the pressure will be put on him. He will start crying. So I pity him. You are allowing your destiny to be used as a toy because you are pitying somebody who is under sexual pressure. And someone say, I'm afraid I will lose him. Since he's asking for it, and it's a long time before I find this one, if I agree now, I will lose him. You better lose him and go and get a proper person. Someone will say, I want to acquire experience. What experience do you want to acquire? Uncompromising holiness is a key to favor. Surrender your life to Jesus. Uncompromising holiness. Then go out of your way to be a blessing to others. Always go out of your way to be a blessing to others. Once you go out of your way to be a blessing to others, God too blesses you. And finally, pray favor magnetizing prayers. Prayers that will magnetize favor into your life. That may take a while, but once you get that into you, you become unconquerable. Rise up on your feet, beloved. And all eyes closed. All eyes closed. There are some prayers we are going to pray here today. Some of the prayers will be to demolish. Some will be to uproot. Some will be to plant. It's all kinds of prayers. Rise up on your feet, all eyes closed. But you see, if you are in this meeting and you are not born again, you have not just surrendered your life to Jesus, we have to go and do some serious prayers. So, wherever you are, please, just leave. I'm only going to count about 10 here. Once I count 10 and you are not here, I believe you don't want to surrender your life to Jesus, we go on with our prayers. But I want to help you. That's why I'm here. So if you are here, you are not born again, you have not just surrendered your life to Jesus, and you want Jesus to touch you today, just find it. Leave your seat and run quickly to the altar here. Well, once I finish counting 10, then we'll finish, then we'll go on with our prayers. Then I believe you don't want to do so. 1. 2.
To Jesus,
3.
I surrender.
4.
5. To my
6.
Savior.
7.
I will ever
8.
Love and trust in
9.
Presence daily. I surrender all. I surrender all to Him, my blessed Savior.
At the altar here, please close your eyes and say what I'm going to say after me. Say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I come before you today. I know you brought me here. Lord Jesus, come into my life. Take control of my life. Beginning from today, I say bye-bye to the devil. I enter into the kingdom of light. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to pray with you now. Father, I thank you for your children here. I pray that you uphold them by your power, that you will lay your hands upon them. The Lord will keep you standing. And this decision you've taken today shall be permanent in your lives. In Jesus' name. Amen. Open your eyes and look at me. You've taken the... But the kind of prayer that we prayed that day, that our brother was enveloped with favor. I know there is somebody here. The kind of favor that will overshadow you, you will become a wonder. Your amen is not loud enough. Stretch your hand towards me at the front here. Let's start from that place. Father, these hands that are stretched here, let his hands receive the touch of fire. Let his hands receive the touch of the anointing. Let his hands receive the touch of the Almighty. Let his hands receive the touch of favor. In the name of Jesus. Lay that hand on your head and keep it there. Don't say anything When I want you to talk, I will say talk. Just keep that hand on your head and keep your eyes closed. Father, we are here today. There are people here who are supposed to be overcomers, but the enemy has pulled them down. There are people here who are supposed to be stinkingly rich, but the enemy has stolen from them. There are people here that are being pulled down every day. Anytime they approach a point of breakthrough, something pulls them behind. There are people here who would have been better than this, if not for these powers pressing them down. Father, where your people are now, as many people as are in this meeting now, as many people as are laying hands on the head, let your anointing that breaketh every yoke, the anointing that pulls out serpents and scorpions and destroys them, the anointing that breaks curses and nullifies them, let that anointing that arises upon a man, and a man will be like a shining star. Let that anointing begin to go from person to person here. And as that anointing goes from person to person, anything inside anyone, whether hidden or unconscious, that is stopping you from becoming what God wants you to become, I challenge that thing now. Whether it is a spirit or a power, whatever it is, let the power of the Almighty begin to challenge them now. Begin to challenge them now. Begin to challenge them now. And as the power of God is challenging them, let every yoke of the oppressor, every yoke of the enemy, every yoke that has kept anyone stagnant, any yoke that has been stealing from anyone, let that yoke be broken to pieces. Right there where your people are, let the yoke be broken to pieces. Let the anointing that has entered into that hand begin to go from the top of the head to the sole of the feet, from the top of the head to the sole of the feet, from the top of the head to the sole of the feet, in the name of Jesus. Just keep your hand on your head. Don't say anything. I don't want you to talk now. When I want you to talk, I will let you know. Father, as many people as are here, and they are being punished, tormented by wicked powers of their own household, where they are standing this morning, let the yoke of that wicked power be broken to pieces now. In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ, anyone whose destiny is being controlled from the waters, anyone whose destiny is being controlled from the sea, anyone whose destiny is being controlled by outside wickedness, anyone whose destiny is being controlled by forest spirits, anyone whose destiny is being controlled by witchcraft powers of their household, anyone whose destiny is being controlled by any evil mouth, anyone whose destiny is being controlled by star hunters, star hijackers, where they are now, let your power begin to envelop such people and set them free, 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 set them free. Every power that does not want you to have favor, and has been pushing you from here to there and causing disgrace, let those powers depart now. In the mighty name of Jesus, receive the touch of heaven right there where you are. In the name of Jesus. Something is happening over there. Jesus!